day, I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day, and you're the reason why I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed. Got this heartbeat in my chest. No, it doesn't matter about the rest. If I got you, Lord, I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed. Hallelujah, I'm blessed. I'm so blessed.
Okay.
Hallelujah, I'm blessed.
And when I count the problems that I see, hope looks on the gone.
Video they're flicking through behind me is just shots of my dad. In most of these photos, my dad's in there somewhere. He's somewhere up there. Within a month of World War One starting, nearly 1,400 New Zealand troops had occupied Western Samoa, which was a German territory. The New Zealanders seized the radio station in Western Samoa in order to help neutralize German territories in the Pacific. In October 1914, the first group of nearly 8,500 soldiers left New Zealand. They were known as an expeditionary force, the NZEF, and they linked up with the Australian Imperial Force, which was the AIF, and they set out for France to join the British expeditionary force there. Over the next 4 years, around 2,000 soldiers left New Zealand every month. Some of the New Zealand and Australian forces were diverted to Egypt to defend the Suez Canal in early 1915. They joined the Allies to fight the Ottoman Empire. However, they were overconfident, they were poorly planned, and they had lack of resources. The Allies landed on Gallipoli Peninsula on the 25th of April 1915, 20 kilometres away from where the British and French forces had landed. In face of a vigorous Turkish response, there was no chance of success, so by early January 1916, all the troops had been evacuated from Gallipoli. In all, 2,779 New Zealanders died. Following this, the Anzac Mounted Division was formed, taking part in the Sinai-Palestine campaign. This campaign cost New Zealand 543 lives. 72,000 volunteers and 32,000 conscripts served overseas with the NZEF. In all, 18,166 New Zealand men and women died in combat in World War One. World War II, the 2nd New Zealand Expeditionary Force pledged to assist in the war effort in Europe, and the first group of them departed in January 1940. Other New Zealanders followed with the served with the Royal Navy, the British Royal Navy, and the British Air Force. In New Zealand 1942, New Zealand's military mobilisation, the largest in its history, peaked with 154,549 men and women under arms and a further 100,000 in the Home Guard. In all, 194,000 men and 10,000 women served in the armed forces in World War II. The fatalities during the conflict numbered nearly 12,000. I want to talk about my family in the armed forces. My dad was concerned that he'd be conscripted into the army in World War II, so he enlisted in the Air Force. Most of these are photos of my dad. Then he and Mum got married before he went off to fight. One of Mum's school friends married Jim, who was another pilot from Dad's unit. Jim was sent off to fight in Europe, but my dad got the mumps and was held back in New Zealand. Within a year, Jim would be dead. Dad later recounted that of the 120 people in that unit that went to England, only six survived. Six survived the war. So mumps probably saved my dad's life. New Zealand then focused on fighting the Japanese in the Pacific, and Dad served three tours there on Vanuatu, Bougainville, Solomons, and Guadalcanal. My dad was preparing to climb out of his cockpit one day when his mechanic climbed up to help him and noticed a bullet had gone through the windscreen, gone through the bulkhead behind him, cut his goggles and cut his ear, you know, an inch to the right, and my dad would have been dead. And believe it or not, back home the family were praying for him, but they were praying that he would be killed rather than taken prisoner by the Japanese, because they'd heard all these stories. Another time, Dad was just on leave in New Zealand, and his squadron went to Rabaul on a bombing run. They went out to bomb something. They encountered very heavy Japanese anti-aircraft fire, and one of the planes was shot down. The pilot parachuted into the sea, and his mates started shooting at the enemy to stop them shooting at the guy in the parachute, and he got shot in the shoulder, but he got to the surface of the water. And they just stayed there as long as their ammunition and their fuel allowed them to, keeping the enemy away from this guy. But in the end, they had to go back to base. They were running out of fuel and they'd run out of ammunition. Another lot went out to save him. Another group of pilots went out to try and save him. But when they got there, he was already floating just on a log. It turned out he actually was alive, but he wasn't very alive and he didn't last much longer. But then a storm came up. And this would have been the squadron that my dad would have gone out with. A storm came up, and two of the pilots flying into the storm flew into each other and died. Three more tried to fly below the storm, hit the water and died. Another one nearly got back to base afterwards and disappeared in a black cloud and was never seen again. And a seventh one died trying to land. He actually went into the lagoon and died too. So Dad knew all these people. He would have been right in the middle of it. And I believe, again, God kept Dad safe. Now, Lawrence asked me to mention a personal lesson I've learned from this research, because I researched this talk for about a day after I was told that I was doing it. My dad would have hated being hailed as a hero. But heroes are normal people who, in spite of their fears and inadequacies, have a go anyway. Many of his friends didn't die, and with them died all their future children and grandchildren. If that bullet had been 1 inch further that way, I would have died. The bullet would have killed me, and it would have killed the 59 descendants that Dad now has. The same can be said for all the German and the Turkish and the Japanese and the Russian men who didn't miss their bullets. All those descendants of theirs died as well. Thankfully, most of us are not going to die in a war, but all of us are going to die. Please, if you don't know where you're going next, come and talk to the team after church today, because no one is guaranteed tomorrow.
I joined the Navy the 9th of January 2009 until 2nd of August 2017. In that time, I did a few humanitarian missions. Basically, Pacific Partnership was the biggest one, where they went to all the Pacific nations and basically said, what do you need help with? So we did veterinary, medical, building, mechanical, all stuff that they needed to get done that the governments couldn't do. And that's basically what we did there. Do a bit of help, got given some fresh fruit and back off to the next country. We've helped from countries like America, Japan, Fiji, all the islands and nations within the Pacific Ocean, obviously. And another one we did, when after Japan got hit by tsunamis and earthquakes, we went there and helped them out, and so they were very thankful for that, because they were nice help, but they were accepted. So that's sort of a brief history of my time in. My great-grandfather was part of the citizens' military in World War II. Basically, he's someone who got a skill or a job, and the government said, we want you to come do various things. So he, as he tells it, he would assemble guns and anything they needed. He was a carpenter, and he said he had no idea why he was working in metal. So they tried to get him to work on the Harbour Bridge at one point. He said, I don't know anything about metal, so no. But I'll get to the main bits now. That's my brief history of like 9 years. And I did nothing except fabricate stuff for the ship. But during World War One, I'm going to do a perspective from the Navy side, because everyone knows the Army stories and all that, but the Navy and Air Force get left out, even though they were part of the time. And we have our own stories, our own parts of it. We're not technically under the Anzac banner, but we are of the same thing and all partnered at the same time. So in World War One, the Navy worked with the Grand Fleet, which was the UK and all the Allies. They searched for enemy raiders over thousands of miles of ocean. Current inter-submarine warfare, which was new at the time, since submarines weren't really a thing before then. Escorted convoys of merchant ships for supplies and troops and anything necessary they needed to get there. Long patrols, which they did blockading enemy ports, and there are some famous ones, where the Germans actually got annoyed with the Australians. Tobruk is a famous one where they helped bomb, this was in World War II, they helped bomb the shores in the Tobruk, and they got given the name Rats of Tobruk, which they took on as, yeah, we'll do that. Even though the symbol of the ship Tobruk is a rat. Like, it's even, then it's sitting on the ocean now, as a dive site now. We were the first to successfully experiment with using planes at sea to take off and land. Mainly because the British always said, oh, you Australians, we'll give you some stuff, you try and do it, see if it works, we'll take the credit for it. And we were the first one to launch planes to the sea. And we were minesweeping operation in Australia because our waters are so big, we could just drop a mine without being seen, so we had to keep patrolling them. We had our first major significant victory at the start of the war when HMAS Sydney destroyed a German raider, the SMS Emden, on November 1914. It was the first big break in the war. It electrified the whole Allied side to say, this can be done. If the Australians can do it, then we can do it. Because we were given less equipment, second-hand equipment, all that stuff. World War I remains Australia's costliest conflict in terms of death and casualties. From a population of fewer than 5,416,809 men enlisted, of whom more than 60,000 were killed and 156,000 wounded, gassed or taken prisoner, a total casualty rate of 64.8%. So it's less than half returned. So that's we weren't. I've read the other reports. We weren't the best prepared for going into World War I because it was something new, and it's, unfortunately, all the Allied nations took the brunt of it because it's just what we did. But in World War II, the Anzacs were the first to defeat the German and the Japanese in battle. Over 27,000 Australians were killed and 23,000 wounded in action. Hundreds more killed or injured due to just accidents during the war, because workplace health and safety wasn't really a thing back then. One of these men, who any Navy people or anyone who knows Navy people will know this story, it was on ABC a while back, one of these men was A.B. Sheehan. He was 18 to 19 years old. He was posted to a minesweeper named HMAS Armadale. At approximately 1 p.m. on December 1st, 1942, five Japanese bombers were spotted by the lookouts. For the next 30 minutes, they attacked, and the gunners beat off their attacks, and the ship escaped any serious damage. 2 hours later, at 3 p.m., nine Japanese bombers, three fighters, and one float plane returned and attacked them. The fighters came in low and fast, strafing the deck with machine gun fire, which this distracted the anti-aircraft gunners. So the bombers came in and attacked from multiple directions, and it hit the ship twice with torpedoes, and the ship immediately began to heel and sink. The order to abandon the ship was given straight away, like, just get off, get out, get in the life rafts. While trying to abandon the ship, they were hit by another torpedo, which threw the remaining sailors across the deck into stuff you don't want to get thrown into, like depth charges, ammunition, fuel, all that stuff. And then some were thrown into the water. That's when A.B. Sheehan made a decision to put his shipmates' lives over his own. It's a 19-year-old kid who, actually, a few weeks before, he should have been at HMAS Cuttable when the Japanese came in and sunk it and killed a whole bunch of people sleeping there. He was sick, wasn't on there. So he managed to get through it. And then he was placed as the HMAS Armadale. So he was wounded and the ship was sinking beneath him. He jumped on his anti-aircraft gun and fired down at the enemy in order for his shipmates to escape. He wasn't trying to hit, he was trying to distract and annoy, which most of us Aussies are good at. He ended up being shot across the chest with strafing machine gun fire, but he wasn't done. He pulled himself up, strapped himself in, so he's just a strap and his white shorts on, covered in blood, holding onto his gun so his mates could get away while he kept firing. And the ship was sinking. There's someone's done a good bit of artwork about him too. He died strapped to his gun, providing a way for his mates and even people he didn't like, probably, to get away and tell his story. And there are stories of them saying, like, they turned around and he was there. There he was, firing at the gun, and everyone was like, what's this kid doing? Like, get away. But his actions allowed a bunch of people to survive and live to this day, or have ancestors that can tell his story as well. He manages to do serious damage to one bomber, causing it to crash into the water over a quarter mile away, which put a bit of fear into the Japanese because we're like, well, we didn't expect this to happen. The Anzacs were such a formidable force, they earned the respect of the enemies that they came up against. One German commander, Erwin Rommel, try saying that one, was quoted as saying, "If I had to take hell, I would use the Australians to take it and the New Zealanders to hold it." This German commander actually loved the Māori brigades. He said if he had three of them, he had no doubt he could win the war. Because he said they were just, you know, so determined, it's hard to get rid of them. And the Australians came and took it, and the New Zealanders wouldn't give up what they were given. So he loved it. The Japanese instructions to their force included the assertion that the fighting spirit of the Australian soldier is strong. Although the Australians are our enemies, their bravery must be admired. And they even placed the Australian spirit, fighting spirit, above that of the Americans and the Marines. To me, the Anzac spirit can't be described in a few words such as mateship and loyalty and all that stuff. But it can be seen through the actions, their earned respects, the stories told by us and the survivors around them, which is why we choose to remember them through songs, stories, poems, paintings, all sorts of that, because it's, even today, you mentioned the Anzacs and people have some sort of connection to it. So it's a thing that's now almost a genetic thing with Australians and New Zealanders. We've earned our place in the world through the sacrifice of these people.
Good morning, everyone. I'm to lead you in a prayer of thankfulness for our Anzacs and what took place there in Gallipoli. Right at the end of my praying, I'm asking you to stand for 1 minute silence. But in honour of the God, our Heavenly Father, we pray to, would you stand right now while I pray? Father God, we honour you today as we come to you in prayer. Lord, you already know that around our country and over in Anzac Cove, the words that our Lord Jesus spoke in John chapter 15 will be spoken again by so many lips. Greater love has no man than this, than to lay down his life for his friends. And here today, Lord, we want to say how thankful we are for the 11,488 New Zealanders and Aussies who were prepared to lay down their lives at Gallipoli, fighting for each other and for our freedom, and for their values they believed in of mateship, determination, endurance and courage. Lord, we're grateful for ones like the stretcher bearer, Simpson Kilpatrick, and his donkey, who over a period of 24 days rescued over 300 wounded servicemen before he himself died from the bullet of a sniper. Lord, we're also grateful for Chaplain Fighting Mac, or Fighting McKenzie, who grabbed a trench shovel and joined the Anzacs charging the enemy lines at Lone Pine, as he was not able by international law to pick up arms. So he grabbed the shovel and joined the men who around him who had said and pleaded with him to stay in the safety of the trench. His reply to them as he climbed up over the parapet and joined the men as they were heading towards the Turkish trenches, he said, "Boys, I've lived with you. I've preached to you and I've prayed with you. Do you think I'm now afraid to die with you?" Mackenzie survived and continued as a chaplain later in France. Father, we're so grateful and thankful as well this morning for your Son Jesus, who we esteem as the hero of all heroes. Amen. Jesus, who laid down his life sacrificially for us when we were lost sheep gone astray, and disobeying you had become your enemies. As your word declares in Romans chapter 5, you, God, demonstrated your own love towards us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And as Romans 5 continues, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of your Son, Jesus. And so this morning, Lord, we thank you, Father, for so many Anzacs dying for us and for each other as mates and friends. And thank you, Father, for your heavenly love when Jesus died for us as your enemies. Amen and amen.
Please remain standing for the minute silent, followed by the last post. Please join me in the reading of the ode, followed by the reveille. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
As we know, Australian and New Zealand men and women have served in all major conflicts, from the Boer War right to present day peacekeeping. And I just want to say thank you to both Colin and Chris for giving us such a wonderful historical view personally about what. But we still serve in peacetime today, and it's my privilege this morning to be praying for those who are still serving in our Defence Forces. 85,000 full-time personnel and active and with active reservists in our Australians. In the New Zealand Forces, the comprise of 4,659 regular force personnel and 2,122 reserve force personnel. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we pray for each one of these 90,000 incredibly brave men and women who serve in our current Australian and New Zealand Defence Force. We thank you for their commitment to the ongoing protection and safety of their respective nations. For those 2,500 Australian and New Zealand personnel who are serving overseas, We pray your protection and well-being over their lives. Grant them wisdom and discernment in the decisions made and the directions taken. To the families who release these amazing men and women to serve their country, we pray your peace, patience, and hope into their lives until the day they meet again. We thank you for their commitment and availability to serve here at home, helping and providing assistance in times of bushfires, floods, and other natural disasters. For those not so much in uniform, but serve also faithfully in our Defence Force, we pray your blessing and protection over them and their families. For the many volunteers that assist our Defence Forces in times of disaster, we pray for their protection and well-being. But Lord Jesus, as much as we have thanked you for the courageous men and women of our Defence Force and for their seemingly sacrificial hearts, we pray that they get a greater sense of you, the one who made the ultimate sacrifice for them. And as you give them peace and comfort in their hearts, Holy Spirit, we pray you will rest those same hearts for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
We stand for the national anthem of both countries.
Love is God.
Please remain standing. I'd like to call upon the worship team to make their way up. Praise God for the Anzacs.
Amen.
The Anzac story is certainly one of those stories that touches a deep part of all of us. It's a story that vibrates deep within the human soul. The same story of sacrifice, love, and hope that is woven through the Anzac story. It's also part of the God story of sacrifice, love, and hope that Jesus Christ paid for each and every one of us. May we always be thankful for those who have gone before us, human and divine, of their examples and commitment and sacrifice. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good works. Church, let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Let's conclude our Anzac service with the Great Southland.
This is our nation. This is our land. This is our future. This is our home. A land of reaping. A land of harvest. This is our land. This is our home.
Thank you.
Father, so many years ago, those words were spoken from the deck of a ship. And Lord, when he looked upon, when that incredible captain, he looked upon the nations of New Zealand and Australia, he felt in his spirit to cry out those words, surely this is the great south land of the Holy Spirit. Lord, that prophetic word, Father God, echoes down through the generations. Lord, it's a sound in a distance that can be heard, and it's a sound in the future that can be heard. That truly this is the great south land of the Holy Spirit. But Lord, we set aside a day, Father God, where we remember our two great nations. But Father, we want to never set aside the fact that we always remember who the God of our two great nations are. That is the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we just pray over our two amazing nations. Lord, I thank you that it says, it talks about them being a jewel in the crown of New Zealand. Father, we thank you that they are certainly a jewel in the crown. And Lord, we pray prophetically over the nation of New Zealand. Father God, a revival in Jesus' name. That Father God, Lord, not the governments will change things, not the peoples will change things, but from within that nation, the Holy Spirit will rise and see a nation that has changed. For Jesus, and Father God, for our own great nation of Australia. Lord, we also continue to prophetically preach. We can prophetically tend to declare over our incredible nation the sovereignty of Christ. Lord, yes, there is an element where we vote for governments. Lord, there is an element within our nations, Father God, where we put people in positions. But Father God, we want you to take the rightful position in our nations. And that is the center, front and center of all the decisions that are made. Lord, we declare these words. Yeah, Lord, we see an environment that is just so diverse. But the environment we want to see in our nation is a revival of Christ. Lord, we want to see our nation changed. And Lord, we remember what these amazing men and women did 100 years ago. But Lord, we remember what you did over 2,000 years ago. Well, you said, it is finished. So the Lord, this morning, with humble hearts, with hearts, Father God, that are emotional, as we go into tomorrow and Lord, that anniversary, let us never forget that Christ is Lord. Jesus is sovereign, and our nation is under his hand. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. Amen.